A very good morning. Welcome to Chartbusters. Well, the Nifty has opened up with some gains. We're sitting with a gain of around 40 points odd. There is some pain in the mid-cap index, though. That's doing a relative underperformance today. Hey, Mangalam, but can't complain when you open up with some green, and we've been quite steady in the last few days. I think that crucial technical level of around 10,750 odd, that's going to be quite a stiff resistance.
Absolutely. Let's see whether we go there or not, because today's day's high, 10,742, and the 200-day moving average have been absolutely the same. Will there be another dash at that level or not is the big question, because I was looking at the Asian markets and they've moved to the high point of the day. All the frontline Asian indices, the Nikkei is now sitting with a gain of over 1%, the Hang Seng, Shanghai, I remember, opening in the red and now has moved to the green. So all the Asian markets doing fairly well. So there is a fair amount of support from the global markets. Let's see whether we make that another dash or not.
Yeah, and some of those metal stocks actually are off the low point of the day. They've been getting hit quite badly. There are various fears that are going on. One is that global growth, is it slowing down? Point number one. Point number two is that, in fact, the rupee has appreciated. Will not be very, very good news because imports get cheaper. And the most important point is that Chinese steel prices have corrected by nearly around 15% odd. So we're bracing ourselves. Come December 1st, I spoke to a lot of dealers. They're saying that's definitely going to be a price cut because importing steel is much cheaper. So let's pull up the metal index. Actually, it's recovered from the low point of the day. Mangalam, there's another thing that I'm looking at. Whether or not Trump and Xi Jinping, you know, whether they can come on the same page, that's going to be important. Now, overnight, U.S. steel stocks were under pressure. You know, if those companies believed that they're not going to come together, then, in fact, you know, those stocks would have held on to this gain. So, the very fact that they're seeing some selling pressure, maybe, in fact, you know, they both of them make peace with each other and both the U.S. and China, they come on the same page, that will be not very good news because all that protection that they've enjoyed, maybe that'll come off. Just maybe. But some of these steel stocks, some of these metal stocks, they've seen a sharp correction in the last 7-8 days. And some of them have come off the low point of the day.
Important meeting to crack that Trump and Xi Jinping. Remember the commentary coming in from the White House.
And the translation also is going to be important.
Absolutely.
This time, because it's not only going to be what they say, but even the translation, you have to keep an eye out on that.
Absolutely, you have to. But, you know, yesterday the commentary that came in from the White House was in absolute English. They said they've been having a lot of conversations with the Chinese officials ahead of that meeting. So we will keep an eye out on that. But our director says headlines, and headlines it is this morning. Yes Bank continues to slide. The stock falls over 4% today after Moody's downgrades the rating on the stock and changes its outlook to negative.
And pharma stocks in news today. Lupin CFO Ramesh Swaminathan resigns while Sun Pharma responds to CNBC TV18 query on the sales note by a foreign brokerage. Says all the information is in public domain. They believe that they are in compliance with all the legal and regulatory provisions.
IOC, BPCL and HPCL trade with modest losses after crude prices see a mild uptick. Brent hovers near the $61 per barrel mark.
An RBL bank falls over 3% today after Kotak Institutional Equities downgrades the bank to sell. They say that there is limited room to remain positive on the bank at current price. Reliance Capital gains today after their asset quality improves in the second quarter of this fiscal.
Arvind trades ex-demerger today. It is the textile business that is trading today. The stock lists at 110 per share under pressure as investors more bullish on the non-demerged branded retail businesses. All right, with that, we get a technical check on the markets. Before we do that, we have a couple of pharmaceutical stocks. They're not doing too well. In fact, Sun Pharmaceuticals opened with a gain of about 1.5%. And then from there, we've seen a bit of a sell-off, currently trading closer to the lower end of today's trading range. We have Dr. Reddy's too, trading closer to the lower end of today's trading range. We have Bajaj Fin from the financial space also moving to the low point of the day. Higher crude, not too good for paint stocks, Asian paints at the low point of the day. But let's get in Ashwini Gujral and his view on the market. Ashwini, we made a dash towards the 200-day moving average once. Do you think there is another shot at that?
See, the problem is that everybody is long now. And if everybody is long, then what shorts are there left to be covered? So what you need is, you know, the market to give you some decline before you have a fresh entry. But if you are in since 10,500, etc., then you can easily put a 10,650, 670 type of stop and continue to ride. But I don't see the market making a dash without going through a reasonable correction. So don't buy today. Buy after, you know, you have one big downside day and there's no follow through on the downside. Today, most likely you are going to be choppy.
And individual stocks, Ashwini, at this point in time?
See, on metal stocks, you know, all this negativity is probably priced in. So I am positive on Tata Steel, Hindalco, etc. You've had 7, 8, 10 sessions of consecutive downsides. So that's as far as metal is concerned and IT is concerned. I think there could be some rotation out of banks into IT and metal. Having said that, Infosys, Tata Elxsi is a buy with a stop of 1010, target of 1055. BML is a buy with a stop of 760, target of 795. And NIT Tech is a buy with a stop of 995, target of 1045. Last couple of days, the large caps in IT have done well. I think there could be some catch up even on mid caps.
Ashwini, a view on L&T Finance Holdings, that stock's moved to the high point of the day, has had a decentish month in an otherwise choppy month for all the financial space, all the financial stocks. So L&T Housing Finance up about 5% this month?
See, from a very long-term perspective, you can buy it. But the issue remains that, you know, this entire NBFC space is a, you know, kind of can of worms, like what happened with PML yesterday. Who has what, that's still getting figured out. But overall, within NBFC, you can say it's one of the outperformers. But overall, the space is fairly controversial, and I doubt it's going to, you know, appreciate in a hurry.
Okay. All right. Ashwini, what about your disclosures?
Well, similar advice has probably been given to our clients also.
Okay, all right. Thanks so much for that, Ashwini. Well, let's move on then. And that's a big CNBC TV18 exclusive. Now, tough times call for tough measures. And CNBC TV18 learns that after months of trying to recapitalize the airline, its promoter Naresh Goyal has finally agreed to sell a controlling stake in Jet Airways. And there are various stocks that are going on as well. Kritika joins in to fill us in with a quick update on this. Kritika, what are you picking up now?
Well, when Jet Airways promoters started looking out and talking to prospective investors, they were very clear that they wanted a minority equity investor to come on board and infuse capital into the company. However, after talks with several investors, including private equity investors and strategic investors, it's very clear that at this point in time, a strategic investor would not want to come on board unless and until Naresh Goyal lets go of control and gives up a controlling stake. So we understand now that Naresh Goyal has clearly communicated that yes, he is now finally willing to let go of a controlling stake in Jet Airways. We do understand that he has met with the three investors that they are talking to at this point in time, which includes Tata Group, Etihad, and a consortium of Air France, KLM and Delta. This is what we have been reporting. Now, he has communicated to them via bankers and via independent meetings that he is now interested in taking talks forward. So yes, all are now entering the next stage of discussions, and he has said that he would like to retain a minority stake. So that would be below 5% is what he has indicated. He would like to continue in the company via a board seat, via perhaps a chairman emeritus kind of a position. Again, that will depend upon the conversation and how they go forward. But he has very clearly indicated that $1 billion is the infusion that is required into the company. And he wants to do what is best for the firm at this point in time. And yes, giving up control is one of the things that he might have to do, and he's willing to do now.
Right, Kritika, hang in there. Seems like the street is taking note of this story right now. The stock up 7% from lows, zooming on the back of the fact that perhaps Naresh Goyal has thrown in the towel looking to sell his controlling stake. You spoke about three potential investors. So what exactly is the position of these potential investors at this point? Why don't you take us through what's on the table?
Well, as we said, investors are now going to reach the next stage of discussion, which will include talking about the valuation and going into the details of the contours of the deal. So as far as the conversation with Tata Group goes, we understand that Tata's are looking, and we had reported this earlier, to take over a controlling stake and eventually merge Vistara with Jet Airways. Earlier, they were actively talking to Jet Airways to take out Etihad's stake as well, but they're open to Etihad continuing as a minority investor. They're also open to Naresh Goyal continuing as a minority investor and open to taking over the debt of the company. They're also talking to Jet Airways for a possible infusion into Jet Privilege as well, but that's going to be a part of the deal. Now, the Etihad offer is different since Etihad is a investor at this point in time with 24% stake. They want to now buy out portion of Naresh Goyal's stake and infuse fresh capital. And as a result of that, they want to hike their stake from 24% to 49% if the deal goes through. Air France, KLM and Delta are investing or are talking to them for a possible investment as a consortium. The talks with Air France, KLM and Delta don't seem to be as serious because there's just been two rounds of discussions so far. They haven't really gone into the nitty-gritty, but so far they have indicated that they want Goyal as well as Etihad's stake in Jet Airways. But it will of course depend on how and what they communicate in the next stage of discussion.
Okay, Kritika, thanks so much for that. Clearly, the stock is reacting to that piece of news. The stock has moved now to the high point of the day. So let's keep an eye out on that. It's now going through the roof, in fact. You know, it's moved up from the lows. I think the stock was trading in the red. And the intraday chart is telling you all the way from around the 285-watt mark, it's moved up by nearly around 8% approximately. So we'll keep an eye out on that. And Kritika will keep getting us the latest on that. Remember, she had broken it here on CNBC TV18 itself when they were in talks with the Tata Group as well.
An eye out on the rupee. It is at the strongest point in today's trading session at the highest level as against the US dollar. Interestingly, even the IT stocks, they're moving higher. That is counterintuitive given Infosys at the high point of the day up about 5.5% in the last three trading sessions. Also, what's interesting is that, you know, the stock has corrected about 20% from the record, so maybe some value buying out there.
You know, Mangalam, just wanted to point out some of these steel stocks. Mm-hmm. You know, the last time what happened was when there was some trouble, this government has been very, very proactive and they've been really taking care of the steel industry in particular. Mm-hmm. Now the street is wondering whether or not there can be some additional protection that will come in there, because we're bracing ourselves for a steel price cut in the first week of December. And some of these smaller stocks, they have got absolutely smashed. You know, they're nearly half of what they were trading at a few months ago. Godavari Power and Ispat, that stock has recovered from the low point of the day. Prakash Industries as well, that stock has halved, more than halved, in fact. That as well is seeing a bit of a bounce. And the metal index on the whole is seeing a bit of a bounce. So I'll be interested to see what is that quantum of the price cut and whether or not, you know, we have the steel ministry that's looking into this, and will there be some kind of protection that will come in there? I'm going to keep my eyes on that. Maybe we'll try to get the steel secretary as well at some point of time and see whether or not, you know, the central government is working to protect the industry, because otherwise it'll get into a bit of a tizzy. You have a lot of capacity that will start coming on stream, and also you have price cuts that are coming about. So that will not be very, very good news.
Absolutely. We will keep an eye out on how the prices in the metal, especially the steel industry, plays out. But talking about prices, let's shift focus now to the cement sector. We understand that All India's cement prices have risen by about 1% month on month in November. So what the outlook is for the cement prices as well as the industry? To discuss this and more, we have Mr. Prasad from NCL Industries as well as Bina Engineer, the director at Sanghi Industries, both cement companies. We go to Mr. Prasad first. Thanks a lot for joining in. If you could tell us what the cement prices are currently per bag, how do they compare to the average prices in the previous quarter, and how do they compare to the average prices year on year?
Yeah, as of date, we are selling at about wholesale prices that are in the range of 270 to 290.
Okay, 270
and
to 290.
If we compare with the Q2 numbers, they are more or less at the same level.
Okay.
So there was no major change.
All right. So that's about the south, but I think we have we'll get to Miss Engineer in just a bit. Sir, if you could help us out with a couple of details. How much of your sales currently are trade and how much of it are non-trade? And if you could give us the price differential in both these two segments.
Yeah, price differential would be around some 25-30 rupees, trade and non-trade.
Okay.
And as of now, we are selling about 60-65% is going into the trade.
Okay.
And the balance 30-35% will be going to the non-trade.
Okay, so it's a favorable mix then. More amount of your sales and the trade segment.
Correct.
Right? Sir, I wanted a quick question as well. You know, we have a couple of capacities that are coming on stream. I think KCP as well is coming on with their capacity in the similar region where you are operating. Don't you think more supply coming on stream, that will add to competition and it will be difficult for you to increase prices?
Sure, the demand is also improving. Demand is also very good.
Okay. Yeah. So no price increase till now, but come December, we normally see some kind of price increase. You're expecting it to happen this time?
Yeah, yeah. The season has started now. The prices are likely to improve in the next coming days.
By how much?
Maybe another 10, 15 rupees.
10, 15 rupees. Okay.
All right, 10, 15 rupees. So that's as far as the South is concerned. Let's move west now. We have Bina Engineer, the director at Sanghi Industries. Thanks a lot, Bina, for joining in. If you could tell us what exactly are the prices right now. We got to understand that there's no change in the South. Has there been a change in the West? How do they compare with the quarter gone by?
Currently, the prices are in the range of about 265, 270 rupees per bag realization.
Mm-hmm.
And in December, probably there should be a marginal hike of another maybe 10 rupees or so.
Okay. How do they compare with the previous quarter?
So, about 1 to 2% better. But as such, if you see the whole first half of this year had about 8 to 10% lower prices compared to the FY18 first half. So they have bottomed out, I would say, and from there they are now on an upward rise.
So that's good news, Ms. Engineer. If you could break it up for us, how much of your sales are trade, how much of it is non-trade as of now, and what's the price differential in the west of the country?
About 60% is non-trade, 40% is trade.
Okay.
So west being a more developed market, the non-trade purchases are generally higher, and
okay,
the price difference is about 10 to 15 rupees.
And you expect to maintain this sort of a mix, or do you expect to get, to move more towards trade?
I think on the whole, it would be similar for the rest of the year also.
Okay.
Right. So we'll go back to Mr. Prasad before we take a short break and continue our discussion. Mr. Prasad, you spoke about, the prices as far as cement is concerned. If you could tell us a little about costs. Have costs topped out in terms of, pet coke as well as imported coal? What are those prices trading at right now?
See, pet coke, we are not using. We thought of using this pet coke, and we got the permission also now. But the pet coke prices as well as the imported coal prices also have started softening.
Okay.
As a result, both the prices are at the same level. So we are using imported coal only.
Okay.
So
you could give us the number, how much does it trade at right now and what was it in the previous quarter?
Earlier we were spending almost 1.35 rupees to 1.40 rupees for 1,000 calories. And now it is working out almost 120 to 125.
120 to 125. Okay. All right. Let's do one thing. We'll just slip into a short break. We'll come back. We'll continue our conversation that we're having with Ms. Engineer as well as Mr. Ravi. At Busters, we have two managements. We're discussing what's the pricing and demand scenario in the northwest as well as in the south of the country. Let's continue that conversation. Ms. Engineer, ma'am, I wanted to ask you, you're talking about prices improving marginally and you're looking, sounding optimistic about prices in December. Tell us in terms of margins and EBITDA per ton, what kind of an improvement can we see? Tell us what's your mix currently of lignite and coal, and those prices have dipped. So what does it do to your EBITDA per ton?
So we still predominantly use imported coal because of the either shortage of lignite or poor quality of lignite, etc. So we'll be using around 80-85% of coal in this quarter also. However, the coal prices have come down by at least about 10%, and therefore that along with the strengthening of rupee benefit will ensure that the fuel cost comes down sequentially. Similar impact on diesel also, so freight cost also, there would be, at least there is no further increment, there could only be savings on freight cost. So these are two major factors where we should see cost cooling down.
So you're seeing cost cooling down, Ms. Engineer. Does that mean EBITDA per ton increases in the second half of this year? I think last quarter was around 550.
Yes, there will be a positive improvement in the EBITDA per ton.
By about what, 80 to 100
rupees
per ton?
For the second half of the year. Yeah, I wouldn't be able to quantify, but it should be in that range.
All right, Ms. Engineer, very quickly, Mr. Prasad was telling us in the south, demand is good. How is the demand in west? Is it looking strong?
It's clearly far better than what we saw at FY18, which was around 4%.
Okay.
The first half of this year, we have seen 15% growth in demand.
Okay.
And the better season is yet to come.
All right. Ms. Engineer, finally, your capacity is going to go from around 4 million tons to 8 million tons. That's on the cards, right, in 2020. Which month should we look at that happening?
the March-April of 2020.
March-April.
It's very much on track, and we have invested about 40% of the funds into the project.
Okay.
All right. On that note, we'll thank both of you all, Mr. Prasad as well as Ms. Engineer. Thank you for joining in. Short point, prices have increased marginally in November, but demand is strong. That's most important. And also, the costs have come off. So the street will be watching out for how these companies report their numbers. With that, we wrap up on Chartbusters. But you stay tuned to CNBC TV 18 Trading Hour comes up next.